A reading from The Beautiful Illusion by Robert Stevens. Now I know what scientists, some, will say. I can imagine what Richard Dawkins would say. There is an objective reality. I'm not anti-science. I love science. I think it's great that we can make measurements of the apparent form. I just don't think the way, the perspective, is correct. I know too that we are ourselves apparent form and that we have to live in and survive in a world of apparent form. This is useful for our everyday lives. I'm merely offering an alternative viewpoint, a way to feel comfortable in the understanding that my personal or our communal perspective is at best deeply flawed and that there is at least one other perspective. This perspective is not difficult to grasp. It's uncomfortable for a while in the beginning because it's a little disorientating, but as the ability to perceive the world so gets more refined and normalizes, it becomes easier and easier to be at peace knowing your true place or part in it. I don't offer the answer to what the most fundamental reality is, merely that this, what we perceive about us, is most definitely not it. I live much the same life as you, probably. I go to work, I do my shopping, I eat and so on. But being aware of the fact that you are apparent form in a world of apparent form makes all of that a great deal more pleasant. It's as if someone told you you can actually jump off buildings and you will fall gently to earth. In the beginning, you would be terrified to try, and rightly so. Once you've done the first jump, though, and found it to be true, jumping off buildings would go through a phase of being incredibly novel and invigorating. After a short while, though, it would just become another fact of life, and lifts and stairs would be novel. Please don't go jumping off buildings. Our perceived reality still has perceived laws that govern it. It's simply that once the perspective has been changed for one less attached and frightening, you have an option to find solace and even pleasure in knowing that there is no thing to be afraid of. If you are no thing, and I don't mean as perceived personality, then you can lose no thing. Everything is okay as it is. You can let go now. I've likened it in the past to living in soup. All about you, the soup boils and bubbles. Forms appear and then disappear. You think you spot something that might be a bit of carrot for a while, then it fades back into the soup. You yourself are the emergence of an apparent form for a while. There are time scales that are very quick. Particles exist for almost no time at all. There are time scales where, for us, forms linger for weeks, months, years, and so on. There are other time scales where forms last for millennia. But from the point of view of it, imagine if time was irrelevant, the duration of these forms would be neither here nor there. A form appears and then melts back into nothingness. It was not there before. It did not exist in that form. And then it's gone again. Be it a quantum particle, a cell, an elephant, a sun, a galaxy, or whatever. It emerges and is absorbed and appears to emerge from a state of no thing. I find this beautiful. It's an illusion, albeit a beautiful one. Don't get me wrong, I love the illusion. It's truly astonishing. In fact, it fills me with awe, genuine awe. It's inspiring and, whenever I walk in nature, literally moves me to tears. It could not be better if it was designed, and no, I'm not an intelligent design proponent. The system is a thing of great beauty in itself, and to think that it all springs out of no thing or emerges within no thing is magical. Nothing is apart. You are not apart or separate. You are an expression of it. Is that not enough to give your little life and put your little mind at peace? Yea, all which it inherits shall dissolve, and like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. Many ask how this is in any way useful for everyday life. Nothing in life changes just because I see the form as an illusion. The answer is the same as the Zen Buddhist example of eating your meal and washing your bowl. Life still goes on the same, but your perspective has fundamentally changed. Your attitude to the forms has changed. The bar isn't full of threatening bikers, but caring people. Life is not out to get you. It's simply a process running along, and it's perfect and beautiful, even if you can't, or choose not to, see it. It doesn't care if you see this or not. You are not expected to. In fact, it has no expectations of you at all. There is no you to have expectations of. It is we, or small I, or ego, or the illusion of a self that places values on all of this. It does not prefer one area of the ever-changing illusion of form over another, as it expresses itself in what appears to be form. All the expressions are equal. They are equally valid and precious. They cannot be imperfect. There is no thing to compare anything to. Without a comparison, how would you tell if something is perfect or not? If there is no perfect template to adhere to or design to attempt to strive towards, there is no way of knowing if a thing is in any way imperfect. If you came across a squidgeon laying on the ground in the forest, how would you know it was the best kind of squidgeon there is without another squidgeon to compare it to? Don't go and Google squidgeon. There is no such thing. I made it up. But you get my point, I hope. Would you say that one particular blade of grass is more or less worth or perfect than another? Yes, I know the scientist in me would say, well, there might be practical or biological differences or advantages, disadvantages to one blade of grass over another. I'm saying, look at the field of grass and tell me that nature prefers one blade over another. Obviously, it does not. All are remarkably unremarkable. They are what they are, serving the greater purpose. And they are all, as they are, perfect. There is no objective version of the perfect blade of grass to compare them to. Perfection is a characteristic of a function. Perfect for what? Nothing, just perfect, inherently and intrinsically perfect. When you gaze upon the world, you are experiencing only the interpretation your brain is giving you from the impulses it receives from its perception senses. Effectively, what you are experiencing of the world about you is the projection of your brain. I have no idea whatsoever what that world out there looks like, sounds like, or anything else. It is as if my head has been opened up and the perceptual contents of my brain have been projected onto the outside world. That is all I can perceive. So, what is the world or reality truly like? I have no idea. What I do know is that there is a continuum from the very small to the very big, and forms beget forms, which in turn beget forms, and none of these forms are real or truly as they are. You look at a human, and it's made up of trillions of cells with little things inside doing stuff. All those things are made up of little things doing stuff. When we zoom out and look at all of that form at a set distance, we say, oh, it's Rob. But Rob is a thing moving around inside a cell, and there are millions of them too. From that set distance, I appear as a city, and then a country, and then an earth, and so on. It's only because you feel like you that you think there is a difference. But the illusion of an ego, a self, is an illusion. There is no you. There never was a you. Your muscles are not the same muscles that made you up 10 years ago. Your bone cells have been replaced and replenished over the years. This is the ship of Theseus. What part of you is you? If every part of you has been replaced or replenished, what can you truly call you? Even your personality has changed. You are not the same person with the same ideas as you were 20 years ago. You've changed. You are an accumulation of many factors, and those factors are in flux like everything else. You are in flux. You are a process, not a set thing. There never was a set thing. Your brain designs a lie that you are a sequence of events happening to a thing, but you are obviously not. That is a lie, and you are hallucinating a lie. There is no you, just as there is no other thing here. Therefore, there is no need to worry about the potential loss of something. If you are nothing and have nothing, how could you ever possibly lose it? You have no self, and therefore the idea that you will be lost, disappear, or be extinguished after the event we call death is ridiculous, not to mention impossible. All of those layers of form you call yourself physical, mental, conceptual, and so on, will be transformed into other forms. But all forms, the old and the new, are illusory. You cannot be transformed into some thing else. There are no things. Therefore, you have never been, you are not, and you never will be. Or if you prefer, you were always, you are, and you cannot ever cease to be, because there is only one, and it is everything. It was never anywhere else, or anything else. I realize that this is a weird mix of things. A physicist will ask what fundamental physics has to do with mental states, or a cosmologist will question the link between a biological creature on a planet somewhere and the formation of a galaxy. I understand that. I understand that they can't directly link the two. My answer, and not a very satisfying one for most physicists or cosmologists, is that all of this is ultimately the same stuff. We don't even know what stuff is. Our universe, as far as we are able to establish at the moment, is made up of 68% so-called dark energy. Just to be clear, dark means we cannot measure it. It is, to all intents and purposes, invisible or not measurable. We can observe the results of this stuff, but not the stuff itself, so we call it dark. Dark matter makes up a further 27%. Again, matter that we cannot measure and therefore dark. A mere 5% of the universe is baryonic or normal matter. That is to say that everything in the universe that we can observe directly, stars, planets, nebulae, galaxies, everything, including you and me, and everything we can observe here around us, makes up just 5%. That's it. So 95% of what is directly around you is not directly observable. We have no idea where gravity comes from. We're working on it. There are many theories like quantum loop gravity, but we just don't know. Its effects are observable, but we have no idea what's causing it. Now, I'm in no way saying science doesn't know everything, therefore we can make up whatever we want. We can't. What I'm saying is that when you take all of this, from the fundamental quantum fields to the ends of the observable universe and everything we can measure and all the stuff we can't, there is nothing that we can separate. Dark energy is affecting events in the universe, even if we don't know what it is. Dense amounts of dark matter create the effect of gravitational lensing. See Hamilton's object. The point is that there are no things to separate. We can make up categories and that's fine. It allows us to get our heads round an otherwise messy looking and complex reality. However, that is us making categories. The universe and reality do not deal in categorizations. The universe, if it could speak, would consider itself to be a whole, one thing. In the same way you consider yourself to be a whole, one thing. You don't say you are a collection of subatomic disturbances in a field that are actually in a cloud of probability, the wave functions of which, once measured, collapse into what can be deemed particles, that these particles make up the atoms, which in turn make up the molecules that combine to build cells and all the structures that are in the cells, like mitochondria, cytoplasm, vacuole, the rough endoplasmic reticulum, the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, ribosomes, and so on. That, however, is what you are. You could continue out into the air and the environment. You take in food which is broken down by your bodily processes and used by the cells to make up you. You are literally what you eat. That is not a trope of some kind. You are literally what you eat. You are literally the air you breathe. You cannot be separated from the environment. Nothing can be separated from anything. This is my point here. There is, in reality, no such thing as separation. There is only one thing, one process. You are a process. You are on one level, a biological process, and on another, an atomic process, or a quantum process, or rather, a series of processes. Everything is a process. The process does not stop at your skin. You is a convenient name we have given to what we deem to be, or observe as,